Bhakti Prasad. Hello everyone and welcome to EPR's interactive session on India's Solar Outlook 2021, powered by Burgeon Solar Power and Energy Limited. Burgeon Solar Power and Energy Limited is well branded for their sales, services, R&D, manufacturing and solar power generation. Burgeon has nurtured a strong and long-standing relationship with its partners across the world. Burgeon has recently installed a solar system working with non-imaging concentrator collector, NICC technology. This system will be helpful either in replacement of cost fuels or like minimizing use of fuel being used by the industries in boilers for steam generation, or it will replace and minimize the dependency upon grid electricity. World's dependency on renewable energy is increasing, with several countries widely investing in highly cost-effective sustainable energy solutions. With the turbulent year of 2020, India's energy sector is slated to expand its solar capacity and has pipelined multiple projects in achieving the renewable energy target. India's renewable energy sector is the fourth most attractive renewable energy market in the world. India is currently at 136 gigawatts of renewable energy generation capacity and is all set to achieve its target by 2022 of achieving 175 gigawatts, much ahead of the time. It is also expected to be in renewable energy generation capacity of 220 gigawatts by 2022. Lower cost of generation due to deflating cost of solar modules and expected R&D in the sector will further reduce the cost of generation and storage, making it more lucrative investments. Also, China has recently announced to have 85% of their total generation from solar. And interestingly, Indian government has set an ambitious target of having 450 gigawatts of renewable energy by 2030. This has opened up new and better opportunities for investments in the sector. Government of India estimates an investment of $20 billion per year to meet this target. This makes 2021 outlook for financing mergers and acquisitions very promising. Today, on this note, you're going to witness an empowering and optimistic session on India's Solar Outlook 2021. Today, industry experts will talk about reinventing the power sector with solar. They would also be talking about the roadblocks in terms of investments, required policy framework, and consumer cost in achieving India's ambitions towards solar. Ladies and gentlemen, it's an honor and privilege for me to introduce you to our distinguished speakers, Dr. Ashwini Kumar, Senior Director, Renewable Energy Technologies at TERI, Mr. Raj Singh Niranjan, Managing Partner at Trans India Law Associates, Dr. Chetan Solanki, Energy Scientist and Professor at IIT Bombay, Mr. Rohit Pandita, Regional Head, Western India at Adani Solar, Mr. Rajinder Kumar Kaura, Chairman and Managing Director at Burgeon Solar Power Energy Limited, and Dr. D.N. Singh, CEO of Burgeon Solar Power and Energy Limited. So delegates, get ready for an interactive and empowering session with our first speaker, Dr. Ashwini Kumar. He is associated with TERI as a Senior Director, Renewable Energy Technologies. He holds a doctorate degree in solar energy from IIT Delhi and continued to carry out his scientific work at IIT Delhi and later at Solar Energy Center. Today, Dr. Kumar will walk us through the present stand of India's solar energy. So delegates, let's welcome Dr. Ashwini Kumar.
I would like to say that the year 2020, if we talk about solar outlook for India, has seen slowing down of the pace, which was in making for last several years. It was mainly due to variety of issues, such as, you know, there has been some delay in signing of power sale agreements at the level of SECI and other some, I would say, intermediaries or procurers, levying safeguard duty, GST, all these features came, then even post-tender, you know, all these issues have started cropping in. There is a provision for what you call change of law in the power purchase agreement, but that takes time in providing the relief to the, I would say, the IPPs. That affects their cash flow situation. And so that has the cumulative effect is the market slowed down. If we talk about, because this is how India planned, that the overall capacity of solar will be a mix of ground mounted plus solar rooftop. If we just have a look at solar rooftop, that also could not pick up the pace as the utility scale. And I think around 10% contribution is happening. There have been, you know, if we just look at why it is happening, why it is not happening, power is a concurrent subject. The state government deals with various provisions, but you know, there have been wide variations in the policies, you know, enabling rooftop. But I think if we just look at the way that what is the profile of the procurement process or procurement tenders, it's easy to note that a lot of innovation has gone into it. Now, the various provisions, like various phrases like round the clock power, which nobody thought earlier that it would be possible with the renewable energy, but the people have you know, started demanding for it. The sector is already seeing debates on utility scale power versus distributed solar power plants. All the distribution companies are now you know, debating this issue, that whether they should continue procuring power from long distantly established solar parks, or they can set up their own distributed solar power projects. But I would say the best part have been the unflinching support of the government to the sector, commitments to meet 100 gigawatt solar target by 2022, declaration of 450 gigawatt by 2030, which comprises 300 gigawatt as per estimates. So that's the best part of the year. In fact, all this hints that 2021 is going to see more emphasis on completing the procurement process wherever it was started. Some tenders were there and the letter of allocations have been issued, but now the completion. And another very important thing which has happened is the Atmanirbhar Bharat policy. Basically, that brings the production-linked incentive scheme. In fact, that's really very significant attempt by the government of India, that on one side, you are trying to scale up the solar capacities in the country at unprecedented, very fast pace. But in order to have that security of the supplies of various ecosystem, the special emphasis is being put by the government through Atmanirbhar Bharat initiative to define policies. So I think I am quite optimistic that we'll see much higher level of activities for domestic manufacturing. And of course, project development by CPSUs, that's another, the government is making a push through CPSUs. That's also going to see a lot of activities. And I would like to see a lot of increase in the procurement tenders, but be assured these are not going to be vanilla, simple vanilla type solar power. There are going to be hybrids, there are going to be storage, demand on storage, there is going to be bundled power, whether it is thermal or with something else. So that will happen. The key issues, the BCD, basic custom duty, that's going to determine the tariff. We all know that the solar power has moved a lot from about, in you know, 18 rupees 10 years back, and now to 2 rupees. But I think I would like to say that let us not be much worried about the tariff now. Let it be 2 rupees or slightly higher also or slightly lower also. But I think this is the time to build capacities, indigenous capacities, capabilities, and to work upon that and do good quality and to remove the apprehensions of the procurers like distribution companies, because they are worried about their lines. What is going to happen if the so much, I would say, solar plus wind power is going to integrate with the grid? So what is going to happen to the grid? So I think we need to work on that. And definitely the procurement process is already taking care of that to some extent, but I think much more has to be done. But to Government of India, I would say, I would like to feel that task is cut ready for itself. I mean, domestic manufacturing policy. Now we need to be very clear, what do we want to do? We have been talking about for the last 10 years that we should have domestic manufacturing, but I think it requires further clarity at what level, whether we want to do only solar module assembly, whether we want to do for solar cells, or we want to start from the basic ingredient of production of silicon. I think I would like to propose that if that clarity is done and the custom duty structure, which is inverted right now, the finished products, they don't attract the duties, the raw material attracts the duty. So that has to be, corrected. So that means, so that's a task cut, and these steps have to be taken. Longer term policy visibility on PLI. And on PLI, I would say what I am heard that government is working on that. My recommendation would be for the country to achieve Atmanirbhar Bharat, that it should be simple to implement. It's not and very clear that where we are hitting, what we want to do for rooftop, because rooftop is going to be important aspect. Consistent policy guidelines need to be adopted, and that effort has to be managed. I would like to say maybe at the level of forum of regulators or bringing all the regulators together. We are working on the solar power, which is largely dominated by solar PV. But very soon, as I just mentioned, that the grid issues are going to be there. So maybe there could be some scope even for CSP or thermal storage kind of applications. That also we should not lose sight of.
Now, I would like to call Mr. Raj Singh Niranjan. He is the managing partner at Trans India Law Associates, the largest law firm in the world in energy sector. And he is the founder of Dr. Gopal Energy Foundation. Today, Mr. Niranjan will discuss about the policies, legal frameworks, and reforms in India's solar sector. So let's welcome Mr. Raj Singh Niranjan.
Thank you, Megha. Thank you so much. And, Dr. Ashwini well said and wonderfully explained the scenario, what we are likely to see on 2021. But sir, main actually a question puchna chahta hun, aap se bhi aur sab se, ki what is the soul of the power sector? Why are we doing what we are doing? Why is the state government, central government or United Nations investing so much of manpower and the investing so much of money in this sector? What is the reason for that? Why are we doing what we are doing, all of us? Aap Megha Iyer ji and Prasad Nair ji magazine chala rahe hain, Dr. D.N. Singh and Mr. Rajendra Kaura is, running a very big establishment. Rohit is helping. We are also helping Adani in a lot of ways in land acquisition. Jo sabse bade land acquisition hai, Trans India Law Associates did. Aapne teri mein, you are doing wonderful job. But why are we doing all these things? That is the question. और यही क्वेश्चन हमारे पास आया था 5-6 साल पहले कि 40 साल पावर सेक्टर में काम करने के बाद वी व्हाई आर वी डूइंग व्हाट वी आर डूइंग दैट वाज द क्वेश्चन. तो हमने जब इसका आंसर खोजने की कोशिश करी तो हमने पूरे वर्ल्ड से एक्सपर्ट्स को बुलाया, यूरोप, नॉर्थ अमेरिका एंड और कॉन्फ्रेंस करा के ये पूछा कि व्हाट इज द बिगेस्ट चैलेंज इन द पावर सेक्टर, एनर्जी सेक्टर. एंड ये क्वेश्चन हमारे मन में था कि व्हाई आर वी डूइंग व्हाट वी आर डूइंग फॉर एनर्जी सेक्टर. और एक दिन जब कॉन्फ्रेंस में डॉक्टर अश्विनी जी बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है, जब वो बैठे कॉन्फ्रेंस में और हमने उनको यही चैलेंज दिया कि क्या सबसे बड़ा चैलेंज है, तो एंड में वो ये बोलते हैं, हम हमेशा ये सोचते थे कि एटीएनसी लॉसेस बहुत बड़ा चैलेंज है, हम ये सोचते थे और भी बहुत सारी डिस्कॉम्स बहुत बड़ा चैलेंज है, बट जो एक्सपर्ट्स ने फाइंड आउट किया वो बहुत अलग था, हमारी सोच से परे था। उन्होंने बोला ये सब नहीं है चैलेंज, और एक नहीं है, तीन मेजर चैलेंजेस है वर्ल्ड में। फर्स्ट बिगेस्ट चैलेंज इज 1.2 बिलियन पीपल अक्रॉस द वर्ल्ड डू नॉट हैव एक्सेस टू इलेक्ट्रिसिटी। वी आर ऑल ब्लेस्ड दैट वी हैव इलेक्ट्रिसिटी एट आवर होम्स एंड वी कैन स्पीक टू ईच अदर। सेकेंड बिगेस्ट चैलेंज इज 3.2 बिलियन पीपल अक्रॉस द वर्ल्ड डू नॉट हैव एक्सेस टू क्लीन फ्यूल टू कुक फूड। सो मदर्स कुक फूड इन अ स्मोकी एनवायरमेंट, दे इनहेल ऑल द पॉइजनस गैसेस, दे गेट सिक, पर वो अकेले सिक नहीं होती, उनका जो बच्चा है 10 साल का एक से, वो भी साथ में बैठता है चूल्हे के पास। सो वर्ल्ड बैंक इन 2017 रिपोर्ट सेज 5 मिलियन पीपल एवरी ईयर डाई बिकॉज ऑफ दिस प्रॉब्लम। कोविड से तो अभी 1 मिलियन ही मरे हैं, उससे भी कम मरे हैं, लेकिन ये तो कंपलसरी है कि 5 मिलियन लोगों को मरना ही है इस प्रॉब्लम की। 3.2 बिलियन पीपल अक्रॉस द वर्ल्ड डू नॉट हैव एक्सेस टू क्लीन फ्यूल टू कुक फूड। थर्ड बिगेस्ट चैलेंज इज दैट इफ इन इंडिया और बिटवीन ट्रॉपिक ऑफ कैंसर एंड ट्रॉपिक ऑफ केप्रिकॉन द पर कैपिटा पावर कंजम्पशन इज 500 यूनिट्स टू 1500 यूनिट्स पर पर्सन पर एनम, देन इन नॉर्थ अमेरिका एंड यूरोप द पर कैपिटा पावर कंजम्पशन इज 15,000 टू 30,000 पर पर्सन पर एनम। आप गैप देखिए उसको, 500 टू 1500 एंड 15,000 टू 30,000 पर पर्सन। इस गैप को हम बोलते हैं एनर्जी पॉवर्टी। ये उन्होंने आंसर दिया एंड आई वॉज शॉक्ड एक्चुअली, मैं क्योंकि जितनी भी मेरी मेंटल थिंकिंग थी पावर सेक्टर के बारे में, ऑन दैट डे इट टुक अ यू टर्न एक्चुअली, एंड आई थैंक दोज एक्सपर्ट्स 2015 में जो असेंबल हुए थे। वी सेड वी विल बी पार्ट ऑफ सॉल्यूशन, वी विल नॉट बी पार्ट ऑफ प्रॉब्लम, वी विल नॉट ब्लेम एनीवन, वी आर रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर आवर सेल्स, लेट अस डू समथिंग एंड बिकम पार्ट ऑफ द सॉल्यूशन। तो हमने स्टार्ट करा राइट टू एनर्जी कैंपेन। इसका मतलब है जिस तरह से राइट टू एजुकेशन इंपॉर्टेंट है, राइट टू हेल्थ इंपॉर्टेंट है, सिमिलरली राइट टू एजुकेशन इज ऑल्सो इंपॉर्टेंट। सो डॉक्टर डी एन सिंह, डॉक्टर अश्विनी जी, मिस्टर राजेंद्र जी एंड एवरी वन, आई वुड लाइक योर सपोर्ट फॉर दिस राइट टू एनर्जी कैंपेन, एंड आई वुड लाइक दैट राइट टू एनर्जी शुड बिकम फंडामेंटल राइट इन ऑल द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशंस ऑफ द वर्ल्ड। इट शुड ऑल्सो बी इंक्लूडेड इन द यूनिवर्सल डिक्लेरेशन ऑफ ह्यूमन राइट्स एज अ बेसिक ह्यूमन राइट। सो दिस इज द आंसर विच वी फाउंड, that this is the soul of the power sector, and let us move to resolve these challenges. And sabse badhiya cheez hai, solution to hamare samne hi baitha hua hai, hum sab solutions hai, aur solution ke sath hamare ye to challenge hai lekin ye bahut badi opportunity bhi hai. Agar hum technologies develop kare for solarization of cooking food, it will be multi-billion dollar business actually. जिस तरह से गैस सिलेंडर लेके लोग जाते हैं, वैसे अगर सोलर पैनल, जब भी घर कोई नया बनाए तो सोलर पैनल लेके फिक्स कर दे और खाना बनाना शुरू कर दे, नथिंग लाइक इट एक्चुअली। सो दिस वाज द फर्स्ट पार्ट, लेट अस कम टू द सेकंड पार्ट। इन द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन ऑफ इंडिया, बिकॉज आई एम अ लॉयर एंड आई एम एक्सपेक्टेड टू स्पीक लॉ, सो कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन ऑफ इंडिया में इलेक्ट्रिसिटी इज अ कॉन्करेंट सब्जेक्ट। इफेक्टिवली इट मीन्स दैट इट इज अ जॉइंट रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी ऑफ सेंट्रल एंड स्टेट गवर्नमेंट। देयर इज अ थॉट प्रोसेस जहां पे सारी चीजें सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट में पुश करी जाती हैं। बट आई लेट मी टेल यू, दिस इज वन ऑफ द मोस्ट एडवांटेजियस पोजिशन फॉर अस, कि भाई हमारे पास सपोर्ट करने की, हमें सपोर्ट देने के लिए स्टेट गवर्नमेंट भी काम कर सकती है और सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट भी काम कर सकती है। कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन ने दोनों को इक्वली पावर दिए हैं कि आप भी लॉ बनाओ, सब कुछ बनाओ आप, और उसको कैसे एक्सरसाइज करने हैं वो भी बताए हैं। सो सेकेंड पार्ट इज बीइंग अ जॉइंट रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी, वी कैन टेक बेनिफिट्स फ्रॉम सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट एंड द स्टेट गवर्नमेंट एंड यू नो मे बी हेल्प एंड वर्क फॉर ग्रेटर गुड ऑफ द सोसाइटी। एंड इसमें क्यों ये इंपॉर्टेंट है ये भी मैं बताता हूँ। क्लाइमेट चेंज इज अ वेरी वेरी बिग इशू एंड द आंसर ऑल्सो लाइज इन द सोलर सेक्टर। So if we can do solarization of e-mobility, solarization of cooking food, nothing like it. Even when I give training to NTPC senior officers, NHPC, PGCIL, SECI, now we have a batch of senior officers of SECI where we are giving training. So kai bar kya hota hai, jo 20-30 saal se kaam kar rahe hai, they are more focused on, DISCOM and traditional way of power sector. Toh main unko bolta hai, renewable energy ka importance kya hai? तो मैं ये क्वेश्चन पूछता हूँ कि सबसे पहली बुक क्या है हमारी, वर्ल्ड की फर्स्ट बुक जो लिखी गई थी वो है ऋग्वेद। ऋग्वेद में सिर्फ अप्रिसिएशन ऑफ नेचर गॉड है, जल देवता का अप्रिसिएशन है, वायु देवता का अप्रिसिएशन है, सूर्य देवता का अप्रिसिएशन है। तो मेरा सिंपल आंसर ये होता है कि अगर जल देवता मतलब हाइड्रो एनर्जी, सूर्य देवता मीन्स सोलर एनर्जी एंड वायु देवता मीन्स विंड एनर्जी से कोई भी एनर्जी ली जाए और यूटिलाइज करी जाए, हमें भी कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं होगी, हमारी नेक्स्ट जनरेशन को भी कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं होगी, क्लाइमेट चेंज भी नहीं होगा। लेकिन अगर हमने गड्ढा खोदा और उसमें चाहे पेट्रोलियम या कोल या न्यूक्लियर एनीथिंग निकाला, पाताल लोक से कुछ भी निकालेंगे हम, तो देयर विल बी चैलेंज। इतना सिंपल है ये। नंबर वन, लेट अस आफ्टर कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन लेट अस कम टू द थर्ड। अब 2021 की बात हो रही है, जो टॉपिक है वो 2021 है। तीन इंपॉर्टेंट डेवलपमेंट है इंटरनेशनल लेवल पे विच विल डिफाइन 2021 एक्चुअली। फर्स्ट डेवलपमेंट जो हो चुका है वो है इंटरनेशनल सोलर अलायंस। आप फर्स्ट पैरा पढ़ोगे ट्रीटी का, बिकॉज आई एम लीगल, ट्रांस इंडिया लॉ एसोसिएट्स इज लीगल एडवाइजर टू इंटरनेशनल सोलर अलायंस। सो ट्रीटी से लेके जितने भी लीगल ओपिनियंस हैं या जितने भी रेगुलेशंस बने हैं, वेदर इट इज एम्प्लॉइज, वेदर इट इज यू नो असेंबली टीम, हमारा एक एसोसिएट एडवोकेट वहीं बैठता था एंड वी टीला ड्राफ्टेड ऑल द रेगुलेशंस ऑफ। उसमें क्या लिखा है फर्स्ट पैराग्राफ में, सिर्फ सिंपल लिखा है $1 trillion टू बी स्पेंट बिटवीन ट्रॉपिक ऑफ कैंसर एंड ट्रॉपिक ऑफ कैप्रिकॉर्न फॉर एप्लीकेशंस इन सोलर सेक्टर। यू सी द अमाउंट ऑफ इन्वेस्टमेंट विच इज एक्सपेक्टेड इन नेक्स्ट 10 years, 2030 तक होने वाला है ये। सो फर्स्ट इंपॉर्टेंट डेवलपमेंट ये है। सेकेंड इंपॉर्टेंट डेवलपमेंट है, नाउ देयर इज अ डिस्कशन एट द फाइनल स्टेजेस फॉर क्रिएटिंग अ वर्ल्ड सोलर बैंक which is likely to disburse $50 billion over the first 10 years. That is important. Third important development है ये, हमेशा हमने power sector पहले city से चलता था power sector, फिर बोला region से चलता था, we had 5 regions, north, south, east, west. Ultimately 2013 तक one national grid बन गया, so now we have opportunity of national grid. But now this will not be true. Now we have started working on international solar power grid. And obviously, जो हमारे South Asian counterparts हैं, नेपाल है, भूटान है और बांग्लादेश है, now NTPC is laying lines for connecting Sri Lanka with India. So South East या BIMSTEC countries तो part one बन जाएंगी, लेकिन पूरा world international solar grid से connect हो जाएगा। And एक executive engineer जो India का था, छत्तीसगढ़ ट्रांसमिशन कॉर्पोरेशन, उसने सबसे पहले प्रपोजल दिया था इंटरनेशनल सोलर ग्रिड का, कि अर्थ का अगर वन पार्ट में सन है और दूसरे पार्ट में अंधेरा है, तो द एंटायर अर्थ कैन हेल्प ईच अदर टू यू नो, देयर आर टेक्निकल चैलेंजेस आई अंडरस्टैंड, बट दिस इज पॉसिबल एक्चुअली। एंड ऑस्ट्रेलियन गवर्नमेंट हैज साइंड अ एग्रीमेंट विद यू नो सिंगापुर गवर्नमेंट टू ले डाउन ट्रांसमिशन लाइन, अंडरसी ट्रांसमिशन लाइन फ्रॉम डार्विन टू सिंगापुर टू प्रोवाइड रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी। So this is the beginning which is happening and the entire world in any way kisi na kisi tarah se connected ho jayega. So third aspect mera ye ho gaya. Ab let us come to, kyunki because the discussion is about policies. Bhai electricity act is clear ki national electricity policy banegi, jo last policy 2005 mein bani thi, which encompasses solar and renewable energy also. सेकेंड इज इलेक्ट्रिसिटी एक्ट में है कि टैरिफ पॉलिसी कंपलसरी बनेगी जो 2016 में बनी थी, विच एनकंपासेस सोलर सेक्टर आल्सो। देन रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी इलेक्ट्रिफिकेशन की पॉलिसी 2006 में भी दैट आल्सो एनकंपासेस। सिंस इट इज अ जॉइंट रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी, अब जो इलेक्ट्रिसिटी अमेंडमेंट एक्ट आया है उसमें उसको सेग्रीगेट करने के ये भी बोला गया है कि अब नेशनल रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी पॉलिसी भी बनाई जाए, सेक्शन 3A इंक्लूड करने की बात करी गई है, अभी वो अमेंडमेंट एक्ट पास नहीं हुआ है। ये तो सेंट्रल लेवल की पॉलिसी की बात है, हाइड्रो पॉलिसी अलग से बनी हुई 2008 में, इट इज नॉट मैंडेटेड इन इलेक्ट्रिसिटी एक्ट, बट द सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट इज फ्री टू मेक पॉलिसी इवन इफ इट इज नॉट देयर इन लॉ एक्चुअली। अब हमेशा क्वेरी आती है कि आप एक ही पॉलिसी क्यों नहीं बनाते, भाई एक पॉलिसी नहीं बन सकती है नेशनल लेवल के लिए। देखो ये हमेशा ये क्वेरी मेरे साथ 100 बार ये क्वेश्चन पूछा जाता है मेरे से कि स्टेट गवर्नमेंट सोलर पॉलिसी क्यों बना रहे हैं, सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट एक यूनिफॉर्म पॉलिसी क्यों नहीं बना दी थी। कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन, अकॉर्डिंग टू द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन ऑफ इंडिया, एक यूनिफॉर्म सोलर पॉलिसी नहीं बन सकती है। उसका रीजन मैं बता देता हूं आपको आज, सो दैट इट इज वेरी क्लियर। उसका रीजन ये है, लैंड एंड एग्रीकल्चर आर स्टेट सब्जेक्ट, सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट कैन डू नथिंग अबाउट इट एक्चुअली। इवन अगर सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट चाहे कि लैंड पे लेजिस्लेशन पास करना है या एग्रीकल्चर पे लेजिस्लेशन पास करना है जो उसका परव्यू है, तो वो नहीं कर सकती। अब चैलेंज ये है जो सोलर पावर, इफ अगर 1 मेगावाट इलेक्ट्रिसिटी प्रोड्यूस करनी है थर्मल पावर से, तो वी नीड 1.2 acres ऑफ लैंड। बट अगर सोलर पावर से हमें 1 मेगावाट इलेक्ट्रिसिटी प्रोड्यूस करनी है, तो पहले तो 9 acres था, लेकिन वो धीरे धीरे कम होकर 5 acres पहुंच गया है, 4.5 acres पहुंच गया है। तो द अमाउंट ऑफ लैंड रिक्वायर्ड फॉर 1 मेगावाट ऑफ सोलर पावर प्लांट इज 5 times द अमाउंट ऑफ लैंड रिक्वायर्ड फॉर अ ट्रेडिशनल यू नो जनरेशन ऑफ इलेक्ट्रिसिटी, एंड लैंड इज अ स्टेट सब्जेक्ट। सो इफेक्टिवली जो सोलर पॉलिसी स्टेट गवर्नमेंट बनाती है, उनको बनाने दीजिए, उन बनाती हैं, उसमें 2-4 बेनिफिट्स होते हैं। एक बेनिफिट ये होता है आपका कि आपको जो रजिस्ट्रेशन चार्जेस होते हैं वो एग्जेम्पशन मिल जाता है। आपको अगर एग्रीकल्चर से इंडस्ट्रियल कन्वर्जन कराना है, उसमें आपको एग्जेम्पशन मिल जाता है। वो स्टेट गवर्नमेंट ही दे सकती है, सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट नहीं दे सकती है। कुछ भी कर ले, वो पॉलिसी बना भी देगी तो दे नहीं सकती वो। पर स्टेट गवर्नमेंट, अब तेलंगाना की पॉलिसी आप देखेंगे तो वो बोलेगी 100 acres से ज्यादा एक्विजिशन हो रहा है सोलर का, तो आपको डीम्ड कन्वर्जन है टू इंडस्ट्रियल यूज, वंडरफुल। कुछ स्टेट्स बोलते हैं कि आपको 50% जो रजिस्ट्रेशन टैक्स लगता है वो आपको नहीं लगेगा, स्टैम्प पेपर जो आपके लगते हैं वो 50% लगेंगे, स्टैम्प पेपर लगेंगे ही नहीं, वो स्टेट गवर्नमेंट ही कर सकती है। तो उनको बनाने दीजिए भाई। एंड देर आर अदर एस्पेक्ट्स ऑल्सो। सो वन एस्पेक्ट अबाउट पॉलिसी इज क्लियर, that there will be two levels of policy. One will be a central level policy, one will be a state level policy. Constitution में जो power central government के पास है, उस वो policy central government की policy आ जाएगी, क्योंकि joint responsibility है। और state government के पास जो powers है, उनको दे नहीं दीजिए आपको facilities, आप इनफैक्ट और ज्यादा facility मांगेंगे कि हमें 1 rupee में land दीजिए। That state government can do, central government cannot do that. So there is a, we should be very clear that there are two levels of policy, and it is a fact. Otherwise, you need a constitutional amendment to move forward. Let us come to the last part of my discussion. अभी जो discussion हो रहा है वो rooftop solar का और net metering का discussion हो रहा है, ठीक है? उसको थोड़ा सा हम लोग just to you know if Megha allows, मैं बस को finish करता हूँ. First thing ये है, in the rules which have recently been made, Electricity Rights of Consumer Rules 2020. It is clearly mandated कि net metering 10 kilowatt के below, up to 10 kilowatt net metering can be allowed by the state electricity regulatory commission. Okay, there is a apprehension कि इससे you know rooftop को या बहुत सारे issues हो जाएंगे, and I also agree partially. क्यों? क्योंकि जब 2001 में electricity, I have written the first book on electricity act 2003. जब 2001-2002 में इलेक्ट्रिसिटी की डिबेट हो रही थी, तब उसमें क्लियरली डिबेट में ये डिस्कस हुआ था कि एक रिटेल मार्केट होगा इलेक्ट्रिसिटी का, एक होलसेल मार्केट होगा, और जो डिविजन था रिटेल और होलसेल मार्केट में वो क्लियर था, वो था 1 मेगावाट। इसका मतलब रिटेल मार्केट जो होगा इलेक्ट्रिसिटी का, वो 1 मेगावाट से बिलो जो है वो रिटेल मार्केट है, और 1 मेगावाट से अबव है होलसेल मार्केट है। So effectively, my view is as law, as per Electricity Act, कि वो 10 kilowatt नहीं होना चाहिए, 1 megawatt होना चाहिए था. But there are, you know, various other aspects also, DISCOMs की जो financial ability है, and वो सब भी ध्यान में रखते हुए. So अभी की position ये है कि net metering 10 kilowatt तक allow कर सकते हैं, लेकिन अभी non, ज्यादा loss नहीं हुआ है, भाई gross metering तो available है आपको above 10 kilowatt. भाई 10 kilowatt के नीचे आप net metering ले लीजिए, एंड 10 किलोवाट के ऊपर, बिकॉज स्टेट की भी जॉइंट रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी, आप डिस्कॉम से रिक्वेस्ट करिए कि उनके प्राइसेस जो ग्रॉस मीटरिंग के जो प्राइसेस आपको मिलते हैं वो ज्यादा बढ़ जाएं, उसको थोड़ा एनहांस करने के लिए हर स्टेट गवर्नमेंट से आप नेगोशिएट कर सकते हैं, जो आपको ज्यादा दे वहां पे आप इन्वेस्टमेंट कर दीजिए। सो फर्स्ट अपॉर्चुनिटी इज नेट मीटरिंग, सेकेंड अपॉर्चुनिटी इज ग्रॉस मीटरिंग विच यू कैन नेगोशिएट विद ऑल द स्पेसिफिक डिस्कॉम्स अक्रॉस इंडिया टू प्रोवाइड देम चीप पावर थ्रू ग्रॉस मीटरिंग। थर्ड, इन द इलेक्ट्रिसिटी एक्ट nobody is stopping all of us from establishing captive power plant even for our households. So the electricity act is clear ki agar aap user hain, aap apne ghar mein ya apni industry mein ya apne khet mein electricity provide karna chahte hain, aap captive power plant kisi bhi amount ka laga lijiye, 1 megawatt, 2 megawatt, it's no, theek hai? First, and de-licensed, no license is required, have your own captive power plant. तो थर्ड है आपका कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट। लेकिन कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट में सिर्फ ये ध्यान रखना पड़ेगा आपको जो आपकी रिक्वायरमेंट है उसकी डबल कैपेसिटी का लगा सकते हो, उससे ज्यादा नहीं, उससे ज्यादा आप लगाओगे तो वो कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट नहीं होगा वो। सो फॉर एग्जाम्पल इफ देर इज अ इंडस्ट्री, देर इज अ फैक्ट्री विच हैज रिक्वायरमेंट ऑफ 3 megawatts, लेट अस अज्यूम, सो वो कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट 6 megawatts का लगा सकता है टू कम विद इन द डेफिनेशन ऑफ कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट, क्योंकि जो डेफिनेशन है कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट, हाउ डू वी आइडेंटिफाई दिस इज अ कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट इट इज नॉट अ कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट, टू टेस्ट है एक्चुअली। फर्स्ट टेस्ट है उस कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट की 26% ओनरशिप उस कैप्टिव यूजर की होनी चाहिए, फर्स्ट टेस्ट है। ये टेस्ट अगर पास हो जाता है तो सेकेंड टेस्ट है। सेकेंड टेस्ट ये है कि 51% ऑफ द इलेक्ट्रिसिटी जो एनुअली जनरेट हो रही है वो कैप्टिव यूजर को यूज करनी चाहिए। अगर ये दो टेस्ट पास हो जाते हैं देन इट इज अ कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट, अदरवाइज इट इज नॉट अ कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट, वो बेनिफिट कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट के नहीं मिलेंगे उसको। सो इफेक्टिवली आपकी जो भी रिक्वायरमेंट है उसका डबल अमाउंट आप कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट लगा लीजिए, नोबडी स्टॉपिंग, एंड उस कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट को अलाउड है आपको पूरे इंडिया में सेल करने का, कुछ और करने की जरूरत नहीं है। पर फॉर एग्जाम्पल यू आर मोर एम्बिशियस, यू हैव, आपकी इंडस्ट्री छोटी है और उसके आसपास लैंड बहुत ज्यादा है, 50 acres एक्स्ट्रा लैंड ले रखा है आपको, तो मर्चेंट पावर प्लांट लगाने में, ओपन एक्सेस लेने में आपको कोई दिक्कत नहीं, थोड़ी एफर्ट्स करने पड़ेंगे आपको, पर आप रेवेन्यूज भी तो मिल रहे हैं आपको। सो आई विल टेक 4 stages में अवेलेबल है आपको, आपको नेट मीटरिंग की फैसिलिटी अवेलेबल है, गो अहेड, आपको ग्रॉस मीटरिंग की फैसिलिटी अवेलेबल है, गो अहेड, आपको कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट लगाने में, कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट लगाने में 5-6 benefits होते हैं दैट आई शुड टेल। एक तो नंबर वन, आपको डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन का लाइसेंस नहीं लेना है, आप अपनी कॉलोनीज को जब फैक्ट्री के आसपास कॉलोनीज को जब सप्लाई करते हैं इलेक्ट्रिसिटी, नो डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन लाइसेंस रिक्वायर्ड। सेकेंड बेनिफिट, आपको ट्रांसमिशन का लाइसेंस नहीं लेना है, इसका मतलब ये है आपका जो कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट 1 kilometer दूर भी है और आप ट्रांसमिशन लाइन लगा रहे हैं, नो रिक्वायरमेंट ऑफ ट्रांसमिशन लाइन। थर्ड, आपको क्रॉस सब्सिडी सरचार्ज देने की जरूरत नहीं है, इलेक्ट्रिसिटी एक्ट में लिखा है, कोई कुछ नहीं कर सकता इसके बारे में। फोर्थ, आपको जो एडिशनल सरचार्ज है वो देने की जरूरत नहीं है क्योंकि कोई स्टैंड बाय आपके लिए खड़ा ही नहीं है। तो 4 benefit ये आपको इफेक्टिवली इलेक्ट्रिसिटी एक्ट से मिल रहे हैं, और पॉलिसीज वगैरह से अलग बेनिफिट मिल रहे हैं, वो आपको देखना पड़ेगा क्या करना है। तो थर्ड है कैप्टिव पावर प्लांट, फोर्थ है मर्चेंट पावर प्लांट, अगर आपके पास बहुत जगह है और ओपन एक्सेस से आप लेना चाहते हैं और थोड़ा कागजी कार्रवाई करना चाहते हैं आप कहिए, यू गो अहेड। सो विद दिस, विद द परमिशन ऑफ डॉक्टर अश्विनी कुमार, आई कंक्लूड माय डिस्कशन।
आवर नेक्स्ट सबमिशन विल बी प्रेजेंटेड बाय मिस्टर रोहित पंडिता, हु इज प्रेजेंटली पोजीशनड एट अडानी सोलर एज अ रीजनल हेड फॉर वेस्टर्न इंडिया। His responsibilities include creating business activities as leads in solar module businesses, creating sales and marketing investment strategies. He is a BE in electronics and communications and an MBA in business administration with an experience of 8 years in power sector and renewable energy. Today, Mr. Pandita is going to discuss about the rise of solar PV business in India. So, delegates, let's welcome Mr. Rohit Pandita.
I will just discuss one happening that happened with me 3 or 4 years back. I was getting interviewed for a Chevening scholarship. So I was told the same question, why we are doing this renewable energy? What is the crux of that? So my answer was, exactly same that which was just told by my earlier panelist about the carbon emissions and how much is being inhaled by the women who are cooking the food with their children, and that was the alarming thing for that time. So these things are relatable. I mean, it's happening across the globe, and that's why solar came into picture. And firstly, it started with the heating systems, and they thought like we were in my 8th or 10th class. We used to write on the paper about the solar cooker. We used to get the sun get heated with that, and it used to cook the food. This was the primary thing I was introduced with the solar in my life. Then when we moved forward towards engineering, then we were told now we can produce electricity of a new technology, which was already in place, but we were introduced with that in our engineering times. The rise started happening from that time. I mean, it's way back, but in India, we can say from 2014, since it was there, I mean, there was a plan of 20 gigawatts for solar PV technology to get 20 gigawatt for India. But in 2014, when the plan was revised to 100 gigawatt, so that was a time when it was the alarming thing, and it was a very great initiative. And then the Paris climate summit happened, wherein all the countries came together and they had to join hands and give some solution for the whole world till 2030 and to cut their carbon emissions, GHG emissions. So presently, when we see as on today, we have moved a lot. In these 6-7 years, India has done a lot and we have contributed a lot in the renewable space, be it wind, be it solar, be it other renewable sources also, majorly being wind and solar. And with the great vision of SECI also, wherein they started this reverse bidding auctions in 2016-2017, when I remember saying 1 megawatt of installations of rooftop was a big thing at that time in 2016-17. But then the bidding started of 500 megawatts, 1 gigawatt, 2 gigawatts, pricing were discovered at 2.5, 2.64. So we saw the rise happening in these 4 years, 4-5 years. And this pushed all the big companies, all the big corporates like we, Adani. So we started our investments in solar segment. We have the largest manufacturing of modules and cells in place currently in India at Mundra, 1.5 gigawatts. We're expanding it to another 1.2 gigawatts. So that will make it cumulative 3.5 gigawatts of cell and modules. So we are shipping to US also. Our shipments are 40% to US. So we can now say that our modules made in India are being used by the people in the developed countries also. And not only we, Vikram is doing that and other manufacturers are doing that. So as a whole, the solar industry has grown and the rise is evident in front of us. That's why we're discussing today primarily on solar. And if we see, everything was happening in the utility segment. Big tenders were coming in for say large solar parks in Karnataka, in Rajasthan. But the movement was not that much in the rooftop segment. There were various challenges of state discoms. They were already having very less cash flows and very less revenues. So switching to solar was quite tough for them. That's why initially when the policy was designed, it was to be initiated by the SNAs, the state nodal agencies. They were about to push for this for the rest of the rooftop segments. But after that, when DISCOMs came into picture, and just 2 or 3 years back only, there was a policy change. Now everything will be driven by the state DISCOMs only. So you will see from the past 2 years, tenders coming from the state DISCOMs only. And I have witnessed the largest tender in rooftop, the Gujarat PGVCL. It came in 2019. It was a 600 megawatt of rooftop tender. So which is unheard of, right? And we were lucky to supply at least 150 megawatt in that, in rooftop in Gujarat only. And there's a new tender in place, again 600 megawatt in rooftop. So the plan of Gujarat is 1800 megawatts by 2022 in rooftop segment. So you can see how ambitious the state is and the country is getting. And recently Maharashtra has introduced the new renewable policy, wherein they will be having 2 gigawatt of rooftop installations in the next 5 years. Then the central government came in with that why can't we use, since we know various state governments give free power to farmers and for the electric consumptions, but that was eventually getting our grid overloaded. Not overloaded, it was adding the load over there. So to compensate that thing, the central government came with a new idea of Kusum, wherein the farmers will be provided with the solar, and they can use the pumps at their farms and can use at their own premises, which will eventually get the load pretty much decreased from the central grid overall. So it is a very ambitious target. And we are again proud to say that we have signed a very great deal with Shakti Pumps, wherein we'll be supplying them around 200 to 300 megawatts in this financial year. And so we as Adani are committed to push a segment wherein we are totally energy independent. we should not be dependent on the developed countries for our own energy needs. I mean, sun is available to everyone, right? So we can make most of that. Now there are various supply chain constraints coming into picture right now, wherein we are somewhat dependent on China for our own raw materials. And the biggest learning for us was in COVID situation, wherein everyone saw what was the impact on ground, right? So that made us to think on that. And that Atmanirbhar program that Government of India is coming up with, so which could have started maybe 4 years later, this COVID pushed it, right? So today we are talking of all make in India, and maybe in solar or in mobile phones, every segment we are talking of making. And this is the need of the hour right now, right? So now we are planning to move towards our ingots and wafers to be manufactured in India only, which will somewhat help us in meeting our own demands in India. China is a home to 70 gigawatt of manufacturing of modules, 70 gigawatt. And we are currently at 3.6 gigawatt of cells and 8 gigawatt of modules. So there's a huge gap in that. So everyone has to come and join together. We can't say that in next 2 or 3 years we will be able to compete with China, but yes, we have started. And as a country, every manufacturer, be it all tier one manufacturers, other manufacturers that are coming up with their own lines, so things are starting. And when we talk about leading the change, then what the best thing that central government did was they led the change with their own efforts. I mean, they introduced the CPSU schemes, wherein they said, okay, we will purchase the power, and there is a mandatory use of VCR component in that. So when the demand was created by the central government, in consultation with the state governments, the demand are generated in the market. So we have plenty of CPSU tenders currently in the market. We have plenty of Kusum related tenders in the market right now. We have plenty of rooftop tenders in the market right now. So demand is there now being generated by the state and central governments. And the supply constraints are there right now. If you see, there was a new policy that came into picture wherein the central government is saying that all the big PSUs and should come up with their own ingots, own polysilicon factories, which is the need of the hour. I mean, raw material is with us, right? You just need sand, right? And everything you have to do within your own country, that can be done. And here also the large PSUs, even the large corporates, can join hand together and get this raw material well in place and get the ingots, wafers manufactured in India only. The rise that from the past 6 years has happened, if the same pace is maintained for next, another 10 years, so we can see in 2030, maybe India will be at a different position where we will be totally free of energy dependency on other countries.
Moving ahead, I would like to invite our next speaker, Mr. Rajinder Kumar Kaura. He is the Chairman and Managing Director at Burgeon Solar Power and Energy Limited. His 43 years of industrial experience explains his contribution in conventional and non-conventional power and electronics across the segment. Today, Mr. Rajinder will discuss about the capital goods in India for solar and electronics industry in India. So, delegates, let's welcome Mr. Rajinder Kumar Kaura.
In my entire life, I have been believing in that as a collective strength and pulling the resources and creating this synergy, we can always achieve much better. So I started my career as a power engineer. I did my master's from Norway. Then I did my second master of engineering from Punjab Engineering College, Chandigarh, in power electronics. Then now you will be a bit abused that at the age of 70, I have joined the doctorate in the BML Munjal University in the perovskites cells. So that we can develop some of the processes. And I am very feel honored that Dr. D.N. Singh, who has got another, you said 43 cent, I will say Dr. D.N. Singh and myself, we both make a one century experience in the industry as well as in all knowledge. So Dr. Singh is my guide, and we are also going to do the doctorate in the perovskites development so that we achieve at least 35% of the efficiency by making tandem cells. So with this background, I am also a proud supplier to say that 90% of the cell line in India has been supplied by us. I have got a team of more than 80 engineers. We are maintaining these lines, and including Adani, we have Tata, we have got the first, we started with Moser Beer and Indosolar. Both have fallen victim to the bankruptcy because of the policies of the government is not right in place, where I am going to speak on the policies for the capital goods requirement. And also small companies like Jupiter's and others, later they became also Afiki government. So we are, for last 37 years, are suppliers of the capital machines. And these machines, I started in electronics. So the whole journey, right from the TV industry, for the computers, for the cell phones, or even Beetle phones, and all these things, I have been supplying machines by importing. So we were representing many foreign companies. But you can see in this whole process, I learned that the after every 4 or 5 years, a new technology comes and a new segment comes. But in my business, I found that printed circuit board was the common factor. You make either a medical equipment or you make any power inverters or a charge controller, but you need a printed circuit board. So PCB industry could not expand, but this is the one area I am working. Why I am talking this, I will come further that why I am speaking on PCB. So then we supplied a lot of plants for manufacturing of printed circuit board in India. Almost 80% of the plants were put up by me, in which there are 260 chemicals are used. There are 32 different processes. And then we make the printed circuit board, multilayers and others. It is a very cumbersome process, but with a highly capital investment also in that. So then our experience said that there is a only and only, you know, the import of the capital machinery. In my today's topic, I would like to highlight that what type of the policies we need so that how we can become independent. There are two new aspects. One aspect is a supply chain, which Dr. Singh is going to speak, that we are from polysilicon and then polysilicon to ingots and wafers and then cells and then the modules. And then even a power electronics we have forgotten because inverters are being dumped. You know, but when the smart inverters will be required and the grid will be becoming more smart, then you will have another pressure that the power electronics have also to be developed equally. So in the supply chain, we can see where we are. We are only manufacturing cells and modules. Cells were also only, my Rohit friend said it is 2.3 gigawatt is the cell manufacturing, 8 gigawatt is the modules. But requirement is 30 gigawatt even for domestic inside India. So how to meet with this gap and why this gap has happened? The reason is that nobody as a think tank in India ever thought that what we are investing, for example, in 100 gigawatt project for solar, $100 billion was the investment. So what you did? You have said, okay, we don't put anti-dumping on China, but we let the everything come, modules come at a dumping place. And the reverse bidding was introduced, which people appreciate, but I condemn it, that because it is the German model, which was a well-tested, that you have to give feed-in tariff, the incentives in the beginning, when the child is small, we feed him and with the bottle. And when you have to send the man to Olympic, then we will see that what internally all the players are the best one and the best player goes outside. So we were in infancy. At the infancy, the government of India introduced reverse bidding. Why? To maintain a tariff, least tariff, the cheapest installation in 100 billion dollars, they may go even for 150 gigawatt. So the government has no idea. And then there was a big lobby between the power, solar power lobby, as well as on the other side, the industry suppliers. So what happened, there was no anti-dumping duty in 2014, which was 2 years efforts of the government were wasted, and we allowed the China to have a free run. The people were coming in the reverse bidding, having a tariff as low as 2 rupees 44 paisa, and then they are going only to China because Indian manufacturers bill of material was much more than the selling price of China. So this was the one of the reasons that the Indian industry could not develop. If you don't develop Indian industry, you don't develop the jobs, you don't have the legs to stand, then you have also in the air because polysilicon and ingots and wafers are missing. So now, after when the tension on the border with the China, and maybe tomorrow if something happens and China totally stops the supply of ingots and wafers, what will you do? Also please study the shift. Few years back in 2000, when solar started, the whole industry was in Germany. And Q-cells and big companies, then some small other companies come, then Korea also came, some Japan companies came. But later on today, you find in Germany, there is not even a single manufacturer like Q-cells. There's no module manufacturers, no cell manufacturer. What happened? The Chinese very cleverly acquired all the agencies, or the Korean acquired the agencies, and these foreign companies, they retained the R&D of Germany, but started mass scale manufacturing in China. And then the China started supplying all the machinery to India and the countries like that. Now India is the biggest market in the world today, but we are totally unprepared in the supply of capital goods. So in capital goods, I would like that all those who are listening, please wake up. You have to make a policy. What China did, I tell you, even since I work with the foreign companies, and every year, 3-4 times in international exhibition, I was going. In Germany, there used to be exhibition Productronica. And in Productronica, there were only Germans, Europeans, they were displaying their capital machinery, how the machine is made and the people are there. But in 5 years' time, we found many halls were full of Chinese. So what Chinese were doing, Chinese made a policy that give a task to the university that these professors will go, they will visit, they will see the technology, then they will buy those machines. Then in the universities, they will just do the reverse engineering. And then they are going to acquire the technique, how to make the machines. So there are, I would not like to repeat, Dr. Singh will tell how many different type of the processes and machines are used in the manufacturing of the different products. But in China, now he is the only supplier. Even today, when you have to put up a new line, or even Adani has to put up the new line, what they will think? They will invite the lot of quotations, and they will find that Chinese is the cheapest. And in spite of the fact, if there will be 40% custom duty on that, they still will be cheaper. And if you put 100% duty, then Chinese will start selling at half of the price. Because Chinese see that how to kill the market in the other country. They study it, they supply at a price which has no match. So all these words which I am using is to tell the government that you have to sit and make a policy that how to develop the capital machinery. Now I say the printed circuit board and the solar in the cell manufacturing and PCB assembly have absolutely common suppliers and common machinery. Only the substrate is changed. In the printed circuit board, you are using the copper clad laminate. And whereas in the solar, you are using the silicon. And then you process it. But two or three more things like co-firing and other furnaces are PVD, PECVD. They were the additional one which are coming from the semiconductor. So had we started the semiconductor like Dr. Singh was having 25 years experience in there, that was the only unit, and even today it is the only unit. The government has very good intentions that we must put up some semiconductor unit, but nobody is coming forward. Whereas you see Americans, they set up a lot many semiconductor fabs in Taiwan, and there are 80 fabs, and they are the suppliers. And China again have no so many fabs. So what we did, we have got no thinker, or should I say that our decision makers are illiterate in that field, that they don't understand what is happening. But when something happens, when the problems come, then we do the firefight. So capital machinery is one area. If you don't develop it, then you won't be able to industrialize the industry in electronics as well as in solar. The next is coming the hydrogen energy. Now in hydrogen energy, when you have to make the electrolyzers and the fuel cells for the electromotive industry, then there will be fuel cells. And fuel cells process and the manufacturing has so many things common in the making of the cells of the solar or the printed circuit board or that. And so there is a need. What we are making a policy, we make a policy, a spec policy or the PLI. But for those who are already in business or who would like to expand or who are already imported the things, but nobody is thinking that how I reduce the cost of the plant. The cost of the plant will be reduced only if you have got in-house ecosystem. If I have to start manufacturing machinery in India today, this means there is no ecosystem. The various parts still I have to import. The motors I have to import. The vacuum pumps I will have to import. Then even there is no manpower available in manufacturing of machines. No engineering college is teaching to machine manufacturing. Why don't we allocate to the different engineering colleges that in the mechanical engineering, this type of the machines will be made. Presses are imported in bulk from China, like the whole automobile industry in the mechanical. They have been importing 100 presses, 200 presses, because they were making metallic parts. Now, however, industry is working in the automobile. There are 20 vendors. And they have once made the installation and investment. Now they are printing the currency every day. And because the buyer is the fixed one, there is this automobile industry or the other car manufacturers like that. In the time to come, the automobile industry is going to see a change from the current states to the electrical vehicle. In the electrical vehicle, in the next 5 years, is going to cause a demand of the power as good as 360 gigawatt, which is today existing. You may need in 2030 even 1 gigawatt. But it is the PV industry which will put, but on the other side, the whole topsy-turvy disruption in the automobile industry will come. In the automobile industry, you have the inverters in the battery-driven car. You have got a battery, you have an inverter. Now the inverter will run the induction motor. But when the hydrogen will come, which Japan has said, we don't want the batteries. What they are doing, they are using the hydrogen and put in the fuel cell, convert it into oxygen from the air and make it electricity, and water is a byproduct. But there is no injection. Same induction motor is working. So interchangeability between battery and hydrogen will be there. So it is in itself is another subject, but we should then think of to making the capital machinery even for the hydrogen technology, for the automobiles. We must see that how much disruption, unemployment will be coming with the mechanical technicians who will not be having any job when there is only electrical vehicles. Then there is a car chargers are there, then maintenance of the car, then induction motors are there. And what is going to happen to the vendors today who are enjoying and sitting mechanical vendors and making the parts for the automobile industry? They will have to switch over to the then electrical vehicle manufacturing. Then they will start learning what is induction motor, how to repair it, what will happen to the repair shops. So in all the totalities, the I think Mr. Niranjan, you should, like you are a legal person and you have done written books also. And I have, I really enjoyed your lecture because there were so many things which even I was not knowing. Similarly, we should pressurize or advise or we should guide this government that to save my country for next one century, please don't repeat the mistakes. Now what we did in 70 years in producing electricity, next 10 years will require the double and three times of that power because now everything is changing, technology is changing. So we should, like your magazine EPR, they should hold some seminars and brainstorming that what should be the policy for capital machinery.
Absolutely.
Why we should not make and why we should not develop the manpower? Why we should not make also the similarly vendors for the capital machinery? So with these words, I will say that capital goods must be taken on priority. Government should treat it as R&D for 5 years. No income tax on that. Let the people develop and let them participate and supply the lines for any supply chain of electronics or for solar at a very, very competitive price. Then you will see the China will not dare to enter in this country and the Chinese economic terrorism can be stopped.
Our next speaker for this session is Dr. D.N. Singh, CEO of Burgeon Power, Solar Power and Energy Limited. He's a solar energy and semiconductor professional. Presently, he is positioned as a CEO where they Burgeon Solar Power and Energy Equipment and technology are providers for silicon solar cell panels are manufactured. He is a PhD again for semiconductor technology from IIT Delhi, and he was trained in VLSI design and manufacturing in USA. Today, Dr. Singh will enlighten us about the status of supply chain building for Indian PV manufacturing. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Dr. D.N. Singh.
Let me say up front that our market is a big market, the third biggest market in PV. PV is a must be realized. And from government side, policies have been announced. BCD also has been announced. So some atmospheric has been prepared. From that rate, we have to have a lot of preparation if we want to serve this big market at our own, because so far we are very, very weak in that direction of supply chains. Basically, we are facing two tyrannies, as Mr. Kumar says, that one is that supply chain side, very, very weak supply chain, almost negligent, and on the technology side. Now, Chinese very cleverly took away the whole PV business from Germany first and then from the whole world. And now they are, and they kind of held the technology for long. 8-10 years, there was no much movement in the PV technology. Same multi-crystalline technology, aluminum BSF technology, or Solanki is here, continued. But suddenly in the last 3-4 years, technology is changing very fast. And that is going to be another challenge, how to cope with it. Just to give you a very quickly example, Today, only 3 gigawatt of manufacturing facility in solar cell is there in the country, and all in multi-crystalline. Wherever, world over, and that means only in China, 85% to 90% production has moved to the mono crystalline technology. So what happens to our even existing capacity, we don't know. But let me quickly come to this slide, which is in front of you. This just to give you the idea, what all is involved in the whole PV manufacturing, PV system manufacturing. It starts from quartzite, though it's sand, but quartzite is kind of a rock. And fortunately we have, so from there, that's available in India, you'll be surprised to know, quite a good amount and good quality in Rajasthan, Bihar, Odisha. But we have not used this resource. But journey from this quartzite to where we get the wafers on which these silicon cells are made, and from there the panels are made and the solar power plants are made, is a very difficult journey. It's not so easy. It's not from quartzite you can make the silicon wafers and that's it. No, in between you have to do the processes and make it pure enough so that your silicon solar cell can work and convert the solar energy into electricity. So you have to make metallurgical grade silicon, you have to make silane to remove the impurities, then you have to make polysilicon. Now polysilicon is the basic ingredient. We have nothing in this country. And then you have to either, from there it separates, either you make mono or multi different techniques, I will not go into that details. And then you make the wafers and then sell. So we have some facility only in cells and modules, and that's also so minuscule. So look at that, that's also so vulnerable. Everything, every ingredient is required to make those also comes from China today or somewhere else. So here, what I am saying is shown here, you see up to the wafer, we don't have anything in the country, no facility, only on cell around 3 gigawatt, and on module we have around 8 gigawatt. And as Dr. Asini said, that we have already 34, 35 gigawatt, now it's 38 gigawatt installation has been done. The market is big, but how do we serve this market? Our ambitions are very high, very lofty. But, and then we say that we want to be Atmanirbhar. Even we don't want to be Atmanirbhar, we will be forced to be Atmanirbhar because it is Chinese. We'll try to twist the market and we will be always under depend on them. Even today, the wafers are not being supplied at a reasonable cost. I just said put together and let me tell you that at Bergen, you see that we have addressing and solar cell that electronics manufacturing and solar cell manufacturing, solar PV manufacturing and automobile also. But our major concentration has been on solar cell PV manufacturing. And we have been supplying technology and equipment in the country, bringing from abroad. Of course, there is no capital equipment manufacturing as you talked about. But presently at the heart of our core of our company, is that to make something and nudge the country towards this self-reliant or Atmanirbhar. And because of that, we are working with several agencies, may it be in government, may it be in private, shoulder to shoulder, and trying to give a lot of information along with Dr. Suni also to tell them that what it takes. So if we talk about a 5 gigawatt kind of nucleus facility, even just 5 gigawatt of nucleus facility, which has everything in the country of parts to metallurgical grade silicon and to the polysilicon to wafer, then what it means, what it can do. So for that, we have to make 35,000 metric ton of silicon, a metallurgical grade silicon. And for that, we will need around $230 million of money, but that can generate 1,200 jobs. If we, for the same capacity, 5 gigawatt, we need 25,000 metric ton, maybe a little less. This case, some of it can be used for semiconductor industry. We need around $800 million investment. 1,400 jobs can be created. If we go for that same 5 gigawatt capacity, polysilicon in ingot, to ingot and wafer plant we make, then we need 5,000 megawatt. We need around $451 million, and which will create around 6,500 jobs. And in total, if we go to the wafer to sell, make it from 3 gigawatt to 5 gigawatt, then we will need around $357 million, and it will create 3,000 jobs in total. If we create this 5 gigawatt supply chain, I'm talking 5 gigawatt, but we must have 20 gigawatt supply chain by, if not before, till 2023, then we have to do 4 times, and it will generate around 12,400 jobs. But in total, if we go to sell, if you can move this side, so around 19,000-20,000 jobs for the 5 gigawatt facility itself. So everything, if you are going to do 20 gigawatt, then quickly let me throw some light on the infrastructure. In the first row, you see that on the same very nodes which are required to be put up for 5 gigawatt, what is the land required and what is the power required. So for Korjai to metallurgical plant, we need around 200,000 square meters, around 50 acre. Same for metallurgical grade to polysilicon, we need 50 acre and 200 megawatt of power. Here, important thing is at these three nodes, again, metallurgical grade to polysilicon, these two nodes, power is, and the third node, wafer to polysilicon to wafers, a lot of power is required, and power plays very critical role. So why Chinese are winning that? They are able to create some situation, a policy by which they supply 2 rupees, 3 rupees, in less than 3 cents per unit. Wherever here we have to pay around 7-8 rupees per unit. So that is a major issue, and that we are taking up with different governments, including MP government, and then some of these things which I cannot reveal it here, that if we somehow can organize, then all these three nodes can be addressed. So electricity is the one major hurdle. In the next slide, I will show you that how difference it makes if we make our polysilicon. If you take a model one, and if you provide electricity as 7 US cent per unit, and then you buy polysilicon from outside, then your wafering cost in the next cost level of the materials and consumables international standard, then you will see that what cost comes per wafer. And then if you do the two model, just reduce the electricity cost to $3, then your polysilicon cost will become $4.5, rather from $11.5 to $4.5. And if you do that, then what happens to the final analysis? In the first model, if you import the polysilicon and you don't do it here, and your electricity remains same, and you do even wafering, then your cost per watt will be around 82 cents. Which is way ahead. You cannot compete at all. And wafer cost will be 50 cents. The wafers are selling at around 43 cents. But if you do just simple things, bring down the electricity cost to around 3 cents, you supply somehow, subsidize or whatever, then your cost can come to 33 cents and very well compete with anybody in the world. So that's some of the key inputs which I would like to share with the audience.
Now, I would like to invite Dr. Chetan Singh Solanki. He is an energy scientist, a PhD in solar EPC towards energy access, energy sustainability, and climate change. He is associated with National Center for Photovoltaic Research and Education as a principal investigator, and he is associated with Energy Swaraj Foundation. Today, Dr. Chetan will apprise us about India's solar scenario. So, delegates, let's welcome Dr. Chetan.
Well, Dr. Singh has mentioned already, Mr. Rajendra has mentioned, I would take a very different stand today than I would have taken 3 years back or 4 years back on what should be our solar scenario that country should follow. And this is for a very simple reason that we have to look at the bigger picture of energy in general, not only the solar energy. And when you look at the bigger picture, you realize that because of the use of energy, the climate is changing, and it has changed, in fact. Many of us do not realize, and many means 99% people do not realize how serious the matter is. And of the remaining 1%, 99% are not taking enough actions. So the matters are really, really worse. We know how seasons have changed and how little time is available for the humanity to really take corrective actions. You know, as per the climate clocks that are running, you know, you can actually Google search and figure out that there are only 7 years left by the time we will reach about 1.5 degrees centigrade global warming, which is beyond which things will start to become irreversible. So therefore, it's a very serious matter. And when it comes to energy, and particularly solar energy, I would like to follow the two Gandhian principle for not only our country, but the entire planet to adopt, without which I believe, as I stand today, that no amount of science and technology development can ever make the human life sustainable on this planet. So first thing is, he said, there is only enough on the planet for everyone's need, not for the greed, and which is very fundamental to the existence of life on this planet. Unfortunately, everything is growing in this world. You know, the production is growing, consumption is growing, but the size of the planet is not growing. The water is not growing, the air is not growing, the soil is not growing, the rivers are not growing. So therefore, there has to be a limit on the consumption. And if you do not put a limit on consumption, as I said, no amount of science and technology can make your life sustainable. Number two, Gandhiji said that we do not need a mass production, but production by masses is required. Because mass production will always result in unequal distribution of resources, and therefore there'll be more unequalness in the society, and that will result in more troubles. So when we apply these two principles of, first, number one, there has to be limit on consumption. Number two, the production has to be distributed. You will suddenly realize that whatever we are doing as a country is really not going to help to solve the problem. It is not only the problem of economic development. It is not only the problem of China is doing this, or we are not doing this, or government is doing that. It is not that. It is about the existential threat to the humanity, which is so alarming at this moment. So when we start putting a limit on the consumption and start distributed production, then we think of what is called energy swaraj. You know, like Gandhiji said 100 years back, what is required is a gram swaraj. We unfortunately did not follow, the world did not follow. But today, I think more than ever we need. So what we need to do is follow energy swaraj. And when we say energy swaraj, it means that energy by locals for locals. So when the local starts generating and supplying the energy needs of local, after putting the limit on our consumption, I think we can really be a sustainable, we can create jobs, we can create livelihood in a local economy, we can strengthen the local people. And of course, government will be independent in importing energy, you know, will save a lot of foreign exchange, etc. So, and that too, the time to do this is so limited that I believe that though the governments are doing good work, particularly our government is doing good work in, you know, promoting solar so much, but I believe that it is beyond the capacity of the government, you know, however strong the government is, whether it's American government, German government, Indian government, to actually bring this change. And this change can happen only through the public and by the public involvement, where we realize that whatever life I'm living today is harming more than actually than what Earth can afford. And therefore, we need to be self-sufficient, sustainable locally. And that's why right now I'm talking to you not from IIT Bombay. I'm talking to you from a bus. And I have started this 11 years long Energy Swaraj Yatra. So I'll go around the world with this message so that more and more people can adopt to the localized energy solution, and we adopt to energy swaraj so that overall we can be self-sufficient. Otherwise, as I said, it's not about doing more that will help us to be sustainable. It is about doing less, and localized will help us to be sustainable. So that's what I would like to say. So for me, the scenario, future scenario for the country is like that, that we locally become self-sufficient. Each individual, each household, each community, each city becomes self-sufficient and generate and fulfill their own energy needs. That is what I see is the future of solar energy for the country.
You know, everybody has pointed out some key questions, but I would like to remind one thing that India is a part of the global countries network and all. There are various international treaties which have to be honored, as a country. And I think one of the key questions in pushing, you know, I would say unbound manner, the domestic content is that WTO. And India started with that, reserving capacities for the domestic manufacturing, and we lost the case. But nevertheless, this is the opportunity we should definitely capture. And I am together with the all, that in order to create those capacities, this is the right time that we can do, because at 17 rupees, 18 rupees, there was no way that we could have done it. But now 2 rupees, even if it goes to 3 rupees, probably we should be able to absorb those kind of price hikes. And what Dr. D.N. Singh has presented, it seems that the pricing, the electricity tariff is the biggest issue. But I don't think now that kind of tariffs are available even from the solar and wind. So that should be possible, I think. So I see a very, very positive outlook that we should be in that. But to answer to your question, I don't see there is any other way. Like everybody has pointed out, there are various issues like cooking energy is not there, the excess energy excess is not there. But I think one solution will not fit all. Probably we are getting into a kind of future where we will have a very big electricity grid, but that will feed to some local smaller grids. And the difference would be in the local smaller grids, there would be some generation capacities that could be through solar, that could be small hydro, that could be of various options. That model probably will come. I think there's no other way except to adopt to all these technologies. You know, rooftop solar is very, very interesting and is going to stage, going to be further, I would say, promoted. What I would like to see as a future that I think rooftop solar with some storage capacities, that's probably is going to happen because everybody is using inverters, and also probably some kind of mechanism will happen. But I think that gives you independence, and we still talk about that we are surplus energy, but if you see at the user end, they don't get the electricity. So that situation is there. So in order to provide them that comfort, I think solar or rooftop, rooftop I use in a very limited way. That is, doesn't mean that you have to necessarily put on the roof. If you have nearby place, you can do that. So smaller solar plants, I'll use that word. So I think that's really going to come.
So how do you see India is going to be self-reliant in terms of PV or any other alternative in regards to solar infrastructure?
My simple answer is that let's get started somewhere. Simple thing is that, you know, I keep saying that we are very much expert in missing the buses. As Ms. Kaura was saying, that when VLSI design or VLSI manufacturing came, we started 82, but somehow missed it. When the telegram revolution came, we hardly make any equipment over here. So these things are very important to realize at this moment of time. Energy is an unescapable need. You cannot escape energy need. People will need energy. And demand will grow and grow. As Ms. Kumar was saying, that EV will be coming. The electronic gadgets, more and more, will be coming. So our requirement is going to be around 1,000 gigawatt by 2030. So, and then if you meet with the fossil fuels, you know all that problem, and you need to go into that. So solar is a must. So if it's a must, and that big market, why do we miss the bus of creating jobs and creating technology and all that? So simple thing is that government has to come in here, as I brought out, that, you know, this infrastructural environmental conditions are very important to do. China is easy to do for them because they are authoritarian state. For us, maybe not that easy, but then it's not that difficult as well. It has to be conveyed in the right level. And kind of what we are trying to do is that create that 5 gigawatt of nuclear facility. Just to inform you, government has announced that Coal India should go for it, a policy will come. And BHEL is being nudged to do that wave. And Reliance has shown interest very recently. And even Adani is showing interest for ingot and wafting. They have loaded some inquiry. So key is that, you know, quickly we should address all the related issues for being competitive. And other thing I keep saying that once we build this facility, we will do a minimum scale, which is competitive enough. And it has to be competitive enough, we should be able to export. We should not be kind of subsidizing and depending upon the BCDs and things like that. I mean, duty, basic custom duties and all that. These are okay to hand holds for a while and to give us the breathing space, but not for long. We have to build things the way others are doing, with the same quality and being competitive.
Yeah.
But we have to make some beginning. Government has to play some role. We are nudging in that direction from Berlin Solar, by working shoulder to shoulder to everybody, as I said. So we are quite hopeful something will start, and then it will take time to build. And we should not, we must not miss this bus.
India has to compete with the global giants like China and other big countries. So we have to have our own, end-to-end raw material ready with us at our own. So for that, I mean, there was a, like I said, there was an inquiry floated by the Consumer Ministry that all the PSUs should come in picture and they should get the things done on the wafers and polysilicon. So the basic raw material is available in India and all the big manufacturers can just get it from within India only. So for that, we have to be, I mean, it's a collective approach. Only a one player or one entity cannot do it, or government alone cannot do it. So everyone has to come hand in hand. We have to push ourselves. I mean, yes, there will be a huge capital cost on this. And since if you see China is at the national mission of, they subsidize their own manufacturers also at times. If they have to kill any markets, they just reduce the pricing. Even after imposition of safeguard duty, which we thought of 25% two years back, that something will happen in India. But China just tried to match it after getting all the things done. So same thing we are just doing in from next year with the imposition of BCD. And then so China will try its best that he will try to safeguard own manufacturers by giving some subsidies to them, so that they can just enter the market and play the value chain over there. So same has to be done by India also. And for that, government has to initiate the steps which they are doing. And we as manufacturers and other participants have to just believe in them, and we have to work collectively rather than cutting each other.
Dr. Chetan, yes. You were addressing about energy Swaraj. What do you see? What are the challenges you see to, you know, make it real for this nation?
Well, I mean, interesting. What are the challenges? Many times I feel that the challenge, of course, two-way. One is what people can do and what government do. I believe that one of the first challenge in today's context comes from the policy, particularly of the subsidy. And I believe that the solar, after 50 years of existence, has matured enough to stand on its own without any subsidy. And subsidy, however, governments are willing to do, is always going to be a very small amount of money that is required to promote the sector, right? So we require really tons of money, which government are never going to have it. You know? So therefore, the small money that they throw out actually disturb the market and therefore becomes a bottleneck. So I sincerely request all the government to stop the subsidy immediately. I'm a brand ambassador of solar energy for Madhya Pradesh government. And I've written to the chief minister to do that. Hopefully some action will be taken. So that is one side. Second side is this free electricity or subsidized electricity is another bottleneck, because if you look at the cost of the solar electricity, it's already very competitive, isn't it? But when people get electricity at no cost or very little cost, there's hardly any motive to shift to the solar. So another suggestion we can say is that rather than, you know, subsidizing electricity, let us provide the benefit with the direct benefit transfer to the people. You know, so even if ledger now, because every bird is linked with the account, the government can put money, you know, every month rather than giving free electricity. Let the person pay the price of the electricity that it is using, so that there is a sense of saving it. And for example, Delhi government's 200 unit policy is one of the worst thing that can happen, you know, and it directly kills solar in that way. And third thing is, people, if we still rely that, you know, government will do something, mera kya hai, it's again not going to be, you know, enough, because it's our life and our children's life that gets affected. You know, if there is a heat wave, then you and I will get affected. You know? If there is a flood, you and I will get affected. If there are spread of diseases, you and I will get affected. So eventually, every individual is affected by the lack of energy, Swaraj, I would say. So therefore, at every platform, we need to put it. But I think the biggest responsibility, I wouldn't say lies on the shoulder of the government. Yes. I would say the biggest responsibility lies on the shoulder of every individual and household, where we stop, or we start becoming independent. And I call it, our mission of our Energy Swaraj movement is asking people to surrender electricity connection. The moment I surrender my electricity connection, I become disciplined user of energy, and I become localized, and I take away the burden from the grid also. And I, in a way, provide help to the government for not importing it, not spending foreign exchange, keeping the foreign exchange reserve. So by becoming independent, I can contribute in a many, many ways. And therefore, the biggest beginning can happen from people. And that's why I call it, the Energy Swaraj has to become a people's movement in order to be successful, and not only limited to India, by the way. The global warming is a global problem, and therefore not one country, two country, 10 countries, but the entire world has to be successful together. I think first time ever in the world, a challenge is there, where the entire world as a community has to be successful together.
I would like to congratulate Dr. D.N. Singh for the wonderful presentation and action plan. I must say, sir, this is doable. This should be done, and this should be replicated into 5 times. At least we should have 25 gigawatts of capacity by 2023. And it is possible. Why it is possible? You can approach for help to central government, but you are free in the policy parameters to approach each individual state governments. So if any state government is willing to give you whatever facilities are required, whether it is a small state of Goa or Sikkim, if you can reach out, it is doable 100%, and you can make it possible. And once you give that example to India, everyone else will replicate, actually. So yes. All yes. Please go out, all out, and all support from all of us. Yes. Secondly, the views of Shri Rajendra Ji Kauraji was super, that we need to invest in the hydrogen sector. And Australian entities have approached me that India being a very big market. So if any industry wants to enter into hydrogen sector, especially green hydrogen, हाइड्रोजन तो बहुत सारी चीजों से बन सकता है, बट वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट ग्रीन हाइड्रोजन थ्रू रिन्यूएबल सोर्सेज ऑफ एनर्जी. इफ इट इज क्रिएटेड, दैट विल बी मोर यूजफुल. सो आई विल बी हैप्पी टू कनेक्ट. चेतन जी इज टॉकिंग अबाउट ग्राम स्वराज, वेयर ही इज सेइंग कि फ्री एनर्जी नहीं देनी चाहिए, बट थोड़ा सा डिफरेंट है, पूरा डिफरेंट नहीं है. आप ये सिचुएशन सिर्फ इमेजिन करिए कि पूरे दिल्ली में सब लोग चूल्हे में, जिन जिन लोगों ने झुग्गी झोपड़ियों में जो भी है या जो भी अफोर्ड कर सकते हैं, वो चूल्हे से खाना बनाना शुरू कर दे. What will happen to climate change? What will happen to pollution level? So even if we have to give electricity free of cost to limited amount of people, we should go ahead with this. It is not for their benefit, Dr. Chetanji, don't mind me. It is not for their benefit. It is for everyone's benefit, because it will mitigate climate change.
Yeah.
It will mitigate pollution.
You give them money as much as you want. Give them 10,000 rupees so that they can pay for electricity. What I'm saying is, make it free, but don't make it without any electricity bill. Let them pay the bill, but you give them 10,000 rupees every month. What is my problem? Give the 10,000 rupees to everyone in the country every month to support the electricity. They should pay for electricity bill.
So, यही discussion करके push करके electricity act में provision ये डाला गया कि जब भी state government कोई भी subsidy देती है, तो advance में payment करें DISCOMs को, which is not being followed actually. But electricity act provides that whenever a subsidy is given by the state government, DISCOM should get advance payment from the state governments.
I will only say that this was a very good brainstorming session. We are standing at the crossroads of the country, where we have to take a call on Atmanirbhar Bharat, and there is a lot to do. Only thing is, we have to synergize. We have not to work in silos. All the big industries, even like Adani, Tata and others, they should come together, join hands and make one big polysilicon available so that the rest of the small units and entrepreneurs, they can be made available a very cheap wafers and they make their own cells. And let every district in India has got so many entrepreneurs making their modules and supplying to their own villages. But we have to, at this juncture, do some thinking, and we have to create a think tank that what should be the policy in the capital machinery. I still say and believe that it is the machinery which gives the mechanical advantage. It is has to be made in India, and this is the future of my country.
This was such an intense and optimistic session, I must say. Thank you, panelists, for exchanging your vital opinions on today's topic of India's Solar Outlook 2021. We hope you enjoyed the session thoroughly. Before wrapping up today's session, we would like to thank our distinguished panelists, Dr. Ashwini Kumar, Mr. Rajinder Kumar Kaura, Dr. D. N. Singh, Mr. Rohit Pandita, Mr. Raj Singh Niranjan, and Dr. Chetan Singh Solanki. I would also like to thank our editor, Mr. Prasad Nair, for taking this initiative. Thanks to our delegates and our love viewers. With this, we would like to announce closing of our today's session. I request you to stay aligned with us for more such sessions. Until then, thank you and goodbye.